Hello dear friends, welcome to teaching learning session of sociology. Today we will discuss about the cultural and migration issues of urban sociology. What is urbanization? We discussed what is urbanization. We discussed about the urbanism in our last lectures. The urbanization is movement of people from rural area to urban area is urbanization. And urbanism is adopting the culture of urban areas is urbanism. So today we'll discuss the cultural issues related to the urbanization. It is the emergence and the growth of some great cities that marks the beginning of urban era. Actually, in western countries, industrialization is one of the factors which is responsible for urbanization. Because of development of industries in big cities, people started moving from rural areas to urban areas in search of jobs. So this emergence or the growth of big cities is the beginning of urbanization or urban era. It is impossible to find a distinct group living amongst themselves away from other group in the day and the age of these cities. The idea of Sumner's primitive society seems to have been eroded with time. Because of the development of the urban areas, people started moving from rural areas to urban areas. Now in rural areas, there was a mechanical solidarity. People were of homogeneous type. But when the people from the different areas move to the cities, then the populations of these urban areas is heterogeneous. It is difficult for them to live separately. Each and every group interact with each other. And this has been described by the Durkheim in terms of organic solidarity. And because of the movement of people from rural areas to urban areas, the Sumner's primitive society seems to have been eroded. Modern era is generally defined by the growth of cities and rapid modernization. While the rate of urbanization has been different in various countries, depending on the influence of industrialization in the respective countries, yet an effect can be seen everywhere. As I told you, in Western countries, industrialization is one of the factors for the development or for the growth of urban areas, is one of the reasons for the urbanization. And these reasons varies from country to country, but still, industrialization is one of the reason for development of the urban area or for the urbanization. This becomes a very crucial aspect of study to understand and to have a understanding of a deeper social problems facing the world today because of the urbanization. As this elaborates the mode of contemporary living and functioning, it is very important to understand the issues related to the urbanization, because it is impacting the lives of each and everyone. Every institution of the society is impacted by the urbanization. So it is very important to study about the urban area and the impact of urbanization on the culture. The pre-existing folk society always has an effect and influence over the ways of daily living. There's a stark divide or discontinuity between rural and urban is difficult to find. In pre-existing folk society, there was an effect and influence over the culture, over the ways of live in. There was a homogeneity among the groups. They were mechanically, there was a mechanical solidarity. They all have same types of skills. A stark divide of discontinuity between rural and urban area is difficult to find. Urbanization is not only an attraction to the rural to urban cities. It is more of an adaptation to an urban mode of living, to the new trends that are associated with city. And through the institutions functioning through the system of transportation and communication in the cities. Urbanization is not only means the movement of people from the rural areas to the urban areas. Urbanization includes urbanism. Urbanism means what? Urbanism means adaptation of the urban mode of living, adaptation of the urban culture, right? Adaptation of new trends associated with the transportation of the urban area. As there is no doubt, there is a difference in the transportation of the rural areas and the urban areas. Adaptation of the living standards of the urban area. Adaptations associated with the functioning of the institutions, right? There are adaptations associated with the communications in the cities. In cities, in rural areas, everyone knows each other. But in cities, this is not the case. There are different sort of communication patterns and the channels in the urban area. So urbanization is not only the movement, but urbanization includes the urbanism. That is adoption of the adaptation or adoption of the culture of the urban areas. As all we know, cities comprises the heterogeneous population, and it is densely populated. Why it is heterogeneous? Because people from all around moves to the city, comes to the city, and they are from the different cultural and social background. So the population of city is heterogeneous. They are not of same type, and because of the large influx of the population, the cities are densely populated. The great city remains dominant for the several reasons, including the existence of vast administrative, financial, and technical facilities. Why people move from rural areas to the urban areas? Because of the advancements, because of the facilities available in the cities. Facilities like administrative facilities, right? Cities have better administrations, right? Cities have financial, cities have more job opportunities. Cities, you can earn in cities better than the rural areas. There is a technological advancement in the cities rather than the rural areas. So these cities dominant because of the technical reasons, because of the administrative reasons, because of the financial reasons. The cultural institutions of growth in the cities, like education facilities, press, theater, concert halls, museums, library, radio stations, professional organization, and so on, are there in these cities. You can compare the educational system of the rural areas and the urban areas. You can compare the entertainment facilities available in the rural areas and the urban areas. Right? So these all are the facilities. These are because of these facilities, because of these cultural enhancements, because of the financial enhancements, because of the technological facilities, because of the cultural facilities, because of the educational facilities. These cities or the urban areas dominate our rural areas. One of the problems faced while understanding urbanism and the cities is the kinds of social action and the organization that exists and function this group of heterogeneous individuals. Although there are so many good things in the about the cities of the urban areas, but there are certain problems. And one of the problems of this urbanism is the social action, the kinds of social actions and the organizations that exist and function this group of heterogeneous individuals. Because population is heterogeneous, so social action must be different, and the organization, it is difficult to understand the social action and the work of the organization or the organizations of the urban areas. A few factors that stands out while theorizing the urbanism is the size. There are certain factors when we theorize the urbanism, there are certain factors on the basis of which we theorize the urbanism, and one of those factors is the size. Increased number of inhabitant is bound to change the characteristic of settlements and the kind of interaction taking place. Because of the large number of influx to the urban area from the rural areas, right, the characteristics of the settlement changes. Because of the influx of these people, there is a development of suburbs. Suburb developed because of the demand of the area, because of the demand of the land, because people need land to live. Right, and development of slums. There is a change in the settlement and the kind of interaction taking place. Interaction like people know each other, but the way they interact with each other differs from the way they interact in the rural areas. A large number of people imply a greater range of variations. Thus, the occupations, cultural lifestyles shall vary here than in the sector of rural habitat, because people comes to the urban area from the various backgrounds, from various social, financial and cultural backgrounds. So their occupation, their lifestyle, their culture vary, right? And it could not be same as it is in the rural areas, because it is a mixed population. Population in the urban area is heterogeneous. The sentiments of sharing a common heritage, taste, lineage is comparatively weaker in the cities because of the heterogeneous population. The increased number of inhabitants means that all members might not be knowing each other personally. In rural areas, what is the common scenario? The common scenario is people know each other personally. But in the cities or in the urban areas, this is not the common scenario. That personal might not be knowing each other personally. Yes, we know our neighbor. We can say hi, hello. We can have a hi, hello terms. But it is not compulsory that we know them personally. So in urban areas, that it is that the people or the members of the surroundings or the neighbors might not know each other personally. So there is no mechanical solidarity. In urban areas, organic solidarity exists. Density. Next point is, next factor is density. Durkheim had remarked about the density that with increased number of population and the static area, the specialization shall increase, as that is the only way an area can support the increase in number. As per the Durkheim, in urban areas, organic solidarity exists and there is a division of the labor, and because of this sharp division of labor, the specialization is required. So as Durkheim said, there is an organic solidarity there in urban areas. There is sharp division of labor and specialization is increased, specialization is increased, specialization might be required, then only one can survive. In urban habitations, the physical contact between becomes close, but social contact may remain distant. The needs of the area are felt and changes are made accordingly. In urban areas, because of the dense population, because population is more and land is static, so people are densely populated. The physical contact becomes close, but not the social contact. We might be living nearby, but it is not necessary or compulsory that we might be knowing them personally. So in urban habitations, physical contact become close, but not the social context. So it impacts the cultural aspects of the society. Next factor about the urbanization is heterogeneity. The social interaction taking place in cities are beyond any caste or class barriers. It hardly matters in the urban areas to which class or caste one belongs. The stratification then becomes even more complex than the simple as it existing in the rural settings. As in the rural settings, the stratification is on the basis of the caste, is on the basis of the class. But this stratification diminishes in the rural, in the urban areas. The interaction takes place beyond the caste and the class barriers, and this makes the stratification more complex with fluctuating status. Individuals are constantly interacting with varied groups, thereby making insecurities a norm of such societies. As our status and norms are very important, and we discussed about the role of the status, roles and norms in our previous lecture. As the status changes, as the status fluctuates, people interacts with the different groups, and this creates an insecurity, right? This also becomes the base for higher sophistication levels amongst the city dwellers. Group membership changes are also quite rapid here, owing to the greater mobility. When you are residing in a place, or when you hold a specific status, you become a member of a specific group. But in urban areas, that the group membership changes because of the greater mobility. Suppose if your status changes, or if you moved out from that place and moved in to some other place, then your group membership changes. Then you become the member of a new group where now you are residing, or you become a member of that that group which is of your status, right? So in because of the greater mobility in urban areas, the group membership changes. With large number of people entering the city space, there is higher depersonalization found in larger cities. People are not bothered or interested in anyone's personal affairs. There is depersonalization in the larger cities. They are busy in their works, while in rural areas, people know each other personally, right? This is the cultural difference between the rural and the urban areas. In urban areas, there is depersonalization, while in rural areas, people personally know each other. Urbanism can be looked at from three vantage points. First is the physical base, comprising of the density of the population, ecological order, and technological existence. These are the three points from which we can look urbanism. That is, the three points are technological existence, ecological order, and density of the population. As the social organization that has several social institutions within it, interrelationships between them as a mix of different attitudes and ideas leading to form of a social control, and social control is very much required, right? The physical and ecological factors make it easier to understand the city with quantification in terms of size, density, and characteristics of a population. The size of the population, the density of the population, and the characteristics of the population are the ecological factors which makes it easier to understand the city, right? It is through the urban population that one can differentiate the cities from the other areas. One of the aspects from which we can differentiate between the cities and other area is the population. In urban areas, population is more. The urban areas are densely populated than the other areas, rather than the towns or the rural areas. The ethnic or racial barrier seems to diminish in the city habitations. There is no racial barriers, there is no ethnic barriers in the urban areas, while in the rural areas there is an ethnic barrier, caste barrier, class barriers, and racial barriers are there in rural areas, but these barriers diminishes in the urban areas. And second point, on the basis of which we can distinguish between the urban areas and the other areas, is the size of the population. The size of the population in urban area is more. Lower birth rate and higher death rate in the cities, these are closely knit with the increasing urbanization. In urban areas, there is a lower birth rate and death rate is higher. So on the basis of the population, on the basis of the birth rate, on the basis of the death rate, and racial barriers and ethnic barrier diminishes, on the basis of this we can differentiate the urban areas from the rural areas or the other areas. The entire gamut of process, institutions, organization, land uses, mobility, professional setups, communication facilities, housing, rental, transportation are all interlinked and cannot be seen in vacuum from one another, forming a city as a whole. City is made up of many organizations, many institutions, many processes. It is a combination of many processes, many institutions, many organizations, like land uses, mobility, professional opportunities, communication facilities, transportation facilities, housing facilities, right? These all are interlinked, and all these forms a city as a whole. All these are the characteristics of a city. We can find a difference of the transportation facilities in the urban areas and the rural areas. Housing, we can find a structure, housing structure, difference in the housing structure in the rural areas and the urban areas. There is a different difference in the communication in the rural areas and the urban areas. We can find out the professional setups, difference in the professional setups or the job opportunities in the rural areas and the urban areas. The urban life is often understood as leading to a weak kinship bonds, less solidarity, and higher individualism. Yes, in cities there is a weak kinship bond because of the culture, because of the demand of the urban life. There is a less kinship bond, while in rural area we see a more kinship bond. People are closely associated with each other. There is a less solidarity, and the organic type of solidarity exists in the cities, and there is a less solidarity in the urban area. People mind their own business. They don't bother about the others, and there is higher individualism in the urban areas, while these are not the feature of the rural areas. It is in contrast to the rural areas. In urban areas, people are individualistic. There is a less solidarity and weaker kinship bond is there. Facilities of recreation, education, etc. are transferred beyond the family groups. There are more educational facilities available in these cities. Recreational activities or transportation facilities exist in these cities. There is change in the fabric of family. The family in urban area is smaller in size, less children, late or no marriages in urban areas. These are the cultural differences in urban areas and the rural areas. In urban areas, families of nuclear type. In rural areas, majority of the families are of joint family types, right? Families of smaller size in urban areas, less children in urban areas, or late or no marriages in urban areas. One can witness the breakdown of the caste and the racial barriers. Income differentiation become a part of the cities. There is a differentiation in earnings of individuals or the groups in the cities. It is not that everyone is earning the same amount, right? There is a difference in the earning level of the individual in the cities because they get their jobs or the amount according to their specialization. And there is breakdown of the caste or the ethnic or the racial barriers in the urban areas. It hardly matters to which ethnicity one belongs to, which race one belongs, or caste hardly matters to the urban people. While in traditional form of groups have lesser control, near groups and a higher interdependence of use exist. There is a less control of the traditional group in the urban areas over the people, right? But a newer group have higher interdependence. The individual's personality and life choices originate from the choices offered by the group pertaining to education, political and religion, etc. The organizational framework forms the interest, ideas, and attitude of the individual. The organization thus may not always keep the interest of each individual in mind. So in urban area, it is not like that the organization keeps the interest of each individual in the mind. And this is the organizational framework which forms the interest, ideas, and the attitude of the individual. And because of this, because organization forms the individual's ideas, interest, and it is not compulsory that organization will keep the interest of each individual in the mind, this leads to the higher suicide rates, delinquent crime rates, and depression and the corruption, etc. There is more cases of depression or suicide in the urban areas rather than the rural areas. The crime rate is higher in the urban areas rather than the rural areas, right? The corruption is more in urban areas rather than the rural areas. Social control is exercised through these formally organized groups in the cities. The social control in the rural areas is because of the solidarity or because of the group. But in urban areas, the social control is exercised through the formally organized group. While in rural areas, it is not necessary that social control is exercised through the formally group. In rural areas, the control is also exercised through the informal groups or the groups which are not formally formed, right? But in urban areas, the social control is exercised only through the formally organized groups, right? And trust units are created to replace the fading territorial ties and kinship groups. Migration. We discussed about the cultural aspect of the urban areas. What is the difference in the cultural aspects of the urban areas and the rural areas, right? In urban areas, the population, let me summarize it for you. First, the cultural aspect, and then we'll move to the migration. Migration problems of the urban areas, right? In urban areas, size of population is more, population is densely populated, right? And then next is there are more job opportunities, educational facilities, transportation facilities, political facilities and other facilities are more in the urban areas, and this impacts the cultural aspects. And the control is exercised in the urban areas through the formal organization. There is less barrier or no barrier of because of the caste or caste, creed or racial barriers are less in urban areas rather than the rural areas. There is a difference in the organization or the housing facilities available in the urban areas. We discuss about all these things, about the difference in the cultural aspects in rural and the urban areas. Now we'll discuss about the migration in urban areas. Right? What is migration? A movement is an integral part of human existence. People always move from one place to another, whether in search of a job or because of any of the reason. A large number of movement, like commuting to and from the place of work, traveling for business or pleasure, etc., are of temporary nature, while some other movements are relatively permanent nature and involve a change of residence from one place to another. People move temporarily or at times permanently from one place to another. When there is a change in the residence from one place to another, then this type of movement is permanent type of the movement. While the people move because of the business opportunities, because of the business or because of the work or because of the pressure, this is a temporary type of the movement. And the movement which results in the change of places of residence of individual are treated as migration. Migration is what? That is permanent movement. When the migration or the movement resulted in the change of place of residence of individual is migration. That is the permanent movement is migration. Social, cultural, political, personal and natural forces have a bearing on migration. Why people migrate from one place to another? Why people changes their residence from one place to another? There are many factors which are responsible for this migration. This could be the political factor, political asylum. We'll discuss about this. There could be the social factors. There could be the cultural factors. There could be the personal factors. There could be the natural forces, natural calamities, which forces the people to move from, to migrate from one place to another. Viewing it as an economic phenomenon receives a special attention. Yes, one of the factor is economic phenomenon. Political prosecution and forced migration are part of non-economic factor, turning many people into refugees and internally displaced person. At times, people move people changes their residence from one country to another country, from one city to another city, from one place to another city because of the political persecution, because of the forced migration. These are the non-economic factor. These factor, the economic factors are not responsible for their migration, but the political factors are responsible for their migration, and people become refugees or internally displaced. Migration refers to movement of people from one geographical location to another, either on temporary or permanent basis. It can be applied to a person and family members moving to another country or region to improve their material or social conditions and improve the prospect for themselves or their family. Migration is movement from one geographical location to another geographical location is migration. It could be permanent or it could be temporary. And this, why the family or the person migrate or move from one place to another? Because of their material and social condition. They want to improve their materialistic condition. They want to improve their social condition. So usually people migrate from one place to another, from one geography to another. Migration is a selective process affecting individuals or families with certain economic, social, educational, and demographic characteristics. People migrate in response to prevailing conditions and the reason for it differ from individual to individual. There are the reason for the migration from one geography to another geography varies from individual to individual. For someone, it could be political persecution. For another, it could be economic factor. For another, it could be job opportunities, right? So the reason for the migration from one geography to another geography varies from individual to individual, right? Migration is a sociological concern, right? Migration includes refugee flows, asylum seekers, internal displacement, and development-induced displacement has increased considerably in volume, the political significance since the end of Cold World War. It includes the refugee flows. People migrate from one place to another, from one geography to another, from one country to another as a refugee. Because of the war, the people migrate from one place to another. The recent example is Ukraine-Russia war, that the people of the Ukraine or the Ukrainian moves out, migrated from their cities, from their houses, from their country to another countries or another geographies, right? So this is migration. So migration includes the refugee flow. See, these refugees, they become the refugees and asylum seekers. At times, government send someone else, or moves out or migrate from the country as an asylum, opts for the asylum. So this is again a migration. Internal displacement is a migration, right? Or the displacement because of the development induced by the development is also a migration. When people move from one geography to another because of the better opportunities, because of the better business or job opportunities, because of the opportunities related to their development, this is a sort of a migration. It has become the internal part of human relationship and is closely linked to the current process of global social transformation. Now, this migration is an integral part of human relationships. Because of the globalization, people from one country moves to the another country, and this is it is closely linked. This migration is closely linked with the global social transformation. Because of the migration, there is a social transformation globally. People from all over the world are intermingling. They are interacting with each other, and this is resulting in global social transformation. Auguste Comte's view that humankind gradually evolved from a theological to a metaphysical and finally a scientific state was based on the idea that a greater concentration of people led to higher and higher stages of civilization. He has given this theory that humankind evolved from the theological to metaphysical to a positivistic or the scientific state, and it is based on the greater concentration of the people, right? And this leads to the higher stages of civilization. When the people evolve from one stage to another stage, they become more civilized. Emil Durkheim was also concerned with the breakup of rural mechanical solidarity consequent on the migration to the cities. Durkheim studied about the migration, and he said, according to Durkheim, he was concerned about the breakup of the mechanical solidarity. There was disintegration of the breakup in the mechanical solidarity of the rural areas because people are migrating to the cities, to the urban areas, and the urban concentration produced a new and more specialized division of labor. And in although there is a division of labor in rural areas, but in urban areas there is more sophisticated division of labor in the urban areas. And because of this division of labor in urban areas, or because of this specialization, the organic solidarity exists in the urban areas, as per the Durkheim, right? Durkheim emphasized the economic changes at the expense of understanding the moral and legal basis of the new order. Instead of mechanical solidarity based on the obedience to custom and tradition, urbanized society required organic solidarity rooted into a mutual needs of each other services. In rural areas, mechanical solidarity is there, although there was a division of labor, but there was no specific division of labor. People have a more or less same set of skills in rural areas, so there was a mechanical solidarity that was based on the obedience. That was mechanical solidarity was based on the customs and traditions. But in urban areas, there is an organic solidarity which is based on the mutual needs, that which is based on the division of labor, right? While Marx was the first of the great 19th century thinker to see migration as a violent process. According to Marx, this migration is a violent process. It is very difficult to leave your home, to leave your land, and to move to some another place. This is violent process, but there are certain factors which forces the people to migrate, to move out from their places. Detaching the peasant from their soil for industrial purpose was a traumatic business. It was difficult for the peasant to leave their land in search of jobs to become an industrial labor. So, according to Marx, this was a violent process. Migration and social structure. There is a profound relationship between migration and social structure, reflecting the varieties of migration types, the complexities of social structure, and reciprocal ways migrations and social structures are related over time in different societies. Migrations are related to the social structure. We discussed about the social structure in our previous lectures, right? So there is a relationship between the migration and social structure. There are varieties of types of migrations, and there is a complexities of social structure. So there is they are integrated. There is an interrelationship between the migration and the social structure. The historical experience of Western nations wherein migration has been associated with industrialization and economic development. Migration to cities of the third world countries resulted from the pushes of the rapid population growth and economic stagnation in rural areas. In Western countries, this industrialization and economic development was the reason for the migration, while in third world countries, there was no much industrialization, but there are certain push factors which forced the people to migrate to the urban areas or to migrate or to leave their areas. That is because it could be economic stagnation in rural areas as cities or the urban areas were developing at a greater pace rather than the urban area, rather than the rural areas, right? Far from being associated with economic growth and development in the third world, it has been suggested that migration there causes poverty and unemployment in urban places. The people from the rural background come to the urban areas, and there was no much industrialization in third world countries, and this influx of population from rural areas to urban areas led to the poverty. This was one of the reasons for the poverty, development of the slums and unemployment in the urban areas, because there is a capacity of each and every urban areas to generate employment, or the land is static in the urban areas, right? So it this influx of the population is one of the reasons for the poverty and unemployment in the urban areas. Why people migrate? Why people move from one place to another? There are various factors or the reasons, right? What are those factors and the reasons? Migration is the movement of people from one place to another. And there are two terms, emigration and immigration. Emigration means leaves their country. When people leaves their country and moves out of their country because of the any of the reasons, that is emigration. And immigration is why immigrate or enters a country. When people enters a country is immigration. Emigration is moving out, and immigration is moving into or entering into a country. People have a different motive for migration. What are those motives or what are those factors? Those are can be the economic reasons, because of the job opportunities, because of the business opportunities, because of the better professional prospects. People move from one place to another, economic reason. Social reasons are the another factor for migration, right? Social reason, people move because as we discussed, that in urban areas there is less barrier or no barrier of racial, ethnic or caste barriers, right? But in rural areas there is a racial, ethnic or caste barrier. So these are the social reasons people move from one place to another. Political reasons are there when the people move from one place to another. And then the environmental reasons, right? Natural calamities like floods, like drought. These are the environmental reasons the people move or they migrate. COVID-19 is one of the reasons now. These are the environmental reasons that people move from one place to another. For migration to take place, there are usually push factors and the pull factors. We discussed about the push and pull factors in our previous lectures also. So there are certain push factors and the pull factors which are responsible for the migration. What are the push factors? Push factors are the reasons that make someone decides to move. This is their own experience of life in one place which gives them good reason to leave it. Push factors are those factors provides a reason to want to move out from the place. It could be the economic reason, it could be the social reason, right? So push factors are negative things like unemployment. Because of the less job opportunities, people move to the another geography. So unemployment is a push factor. Crop failure. In case of agriculture, if the crop fails, if there is no crop, then what one will do, how one will survive? They move out to their place in search of the job. Then floods, droughts, war, push factor. War pushes the individual to move out from their places. Poor education opportunities or poor service conditions and amenities are some of the push factors which forces people to move out from their place to another place, right? These are the negative factors. In India, people migrate from rural to urban area due to poverty, high population pressure, lack of basic infrastructure facilities like healthcare, like education. Apart from these factors, natural disasters like flood, cyclones, earthquake, tsunami, wars, legal conflicts give extra push to migrate. So these are some of the push factors. While there are certain other pull factors, were push factors which forces people to move out from their place to another place. Pull factor, pull. Pull factors are those factors which attract people from rural areas to cities. These are the positive factors. These attract the people to their places. When they, what are the push factors are those factors which forces the people to move to the urban areas or from one geography to another geography. Pull factor which attracts the people to their place. The most important pull factor for majority of rural migrants to urban area is better opportunities, right? No doubt, better opportunities like availability of regular work, higher wages, better opportunities for education, healthcare facilities, sources of entertainment. These are the important pull factors which attracts the people from the other geographies. Right? So, there are the certain push and the pull factors which are responsible for migration. Push factors, remember this thing, push factors are the negative factors and pull factors are the positive factors. Push factor forces the people to move out to the another place and pull factor attracts the people to come to their places. Right? Types of migration and the emerging trends and the pattern of organization in India. There are various types of migration. The first is rural-rural migration that stream the restrict to the shorter distance movement as compared to other rural-urban migration stream. When the people from one rural area moves to the another rural area, that is, this is of shorter the distance type of migration. Second is rural-urban migration. The classic push and pull forces that resulted in people from the poor region migrate to the richer rural and the urban location and resulted in a rising population and deteriorating land. Right? Rural urban, when there are the certain push and the pull factor which forces the people to move from rural to urban areas or a better rural areas. After liberalization of Indian economy, rural-urban migration accelerated, which pushed more member of the rural people to metropolitan areas for better employment opportunities. Liberalization is responsible, leads to the migration, that is rural-urban migration. In rural areas, poverty, unbearable employment, uncertain wages, uneconomic land holding, and inadequate facilities, education are the responsible for the are the push factors for the migration. Right? These are the in urban areas. There are better opportunities and health facilities. And in our next class, we'll discuss about the urban-urban migration. That's all for today. Thank you very much. Namaskar.